Welcome class to our narrated slides having to do with capital gains and depreciation. Well, kind of a kickback to depreciation concepts. So to start with, to understand what capital gains are, we have to define capital assets. So capital assets in the tax law are not listed because really there's no way to list them all. But basically, it's everything that's not one of these four things. So the tax law defines capital asset by saying what it's not. And the big one really is inventory. If it's inventory held for sale, then it is not a capital asset. And if it is asset used in a trade or business, it is not capital. So basically everything else is a capital asset. So how does this affect the taxpayer? Well, short-term capital gains, we harken back to our last chapter, we talked about how to calculate the gain or loss on assets sold. So now we're talking about the time frame that we have the assets. Short-term capital gains come from sales of capital assets held for 1 year or less. Longer than 1 year is long-term. So there's a cutoff, 1 year. The holding period starts typically when a taxpayer acquires the asset and ends when they dispose of it. So that's your holding period. And the question is whether it's 1 year or less or 1 year or more. Actually, 1 year is still short-term, okay? So it is actually got to be past that 1 year to get to long-term by at least a day. So that's the cutoff. Now, this holding period is important, but there are exceptions, and when it doesn't really start when you first get the asset. And there are a couple of exceptions. One exception is if you inherit property, it is long-term no matter how long you hold it. You inherit it from your grandma when she passes away, and no matter when you sell it, no matter how long you actually own it, it is considered long-term. So that's one exception to the general rule that it starts when you buy it or when you acquire it. The other is carryover basis. And this when you have carryover holding period. Remember, we talked about situations where basis was determined not by necessarily what you paid for an asset, but in situations where you get the basis from another taxpayer. And so in the situation generally is if you get basis from the other taxpayer, you're also going to get their holding period as well. Now remember, these will sound familiar. We use the previous owner's basis to compute the basis in the property, like gifts, where we use a donor's basis, and when we have transfers between spouses. So if you receive a gift and you use the donor's basis, the giver's basis, to determine your basis, then you also get to include the previous owner's holding period in calculating your holding period. So it's as if it didn't start when you received the gift, it started when that person who gave you the gift bought it. So when you allocate part of the basis to a newly acquired property like stock splits and taxable stock dividends, stock splits really are ignored in the sense of starting your time period that you held the property. If you own stock and you get a stock split, the holding time for those new shares you got is really the same as all of the shares. That's what that means. And if you adjust the basis from a postponed gain, we talked about like-kind exchanges, involuntary conversions. If you have a like-kind exchange, your holding period for that property is going to include the holding period for the stuff you traded. So you trade property A for property B, your holding period for property B, assuming this, it qualifies for like-kind exchanges that we talked about in Chapter 10, then it you will also, your holding period for property B that you received will include the holding period of property A that you just gave up. So those are the exceptions. Excuse me. So that's important because when we get to our different sales of property, we're going to have two piles, the short term and the long term. And they are taxed a little differently. Well, maybe you might say, some people might say it a lot differently, based on which pile they go into. And that's why that's so important to be able to know what the holding period is. So here's an example. We have short term and long term. We have four different transactions, four different gains. Gains are positive, losses are going to be negative in our example here. Okay, so we how do they net? Meaning, what do we do with these various things to put them on the tax return? We net short-term against short-term and long-term against long-term. That's the first step, or the you might say the most obvious step is we keep everything separated to see where we are net. So a net short-term loss and a net long-term gain. Once we have the two columns, then if they were both the same, then we would be done. But if we're not, if they're not the same, then we take the short term or the smaller amount and offset against the larger amount. So whichever direction that goes, we're going to net the short term against the long term in this case, because it's smaller. And what we end up with is a long-term, net long-term capital gain. Now, if that's the case, and this is where it gets important for your clients, is they pay a lower tax rate on net capital gain than they do on ordinary income. So we're introducing a new idea here, difference between capital gain and ordinary income. Ordinary income is what we've dealt with all along previous to this. Now we have this new class of income that is going to have a different tax rate. It's still included in your AGI. It's still part of your income, but it's taxed at a different rate. So you see that there are three tax brackets on capital gains, and they apply to different taxpayers based on their ordinary income tax bracket. And you notice there's quite a difference. If you normally have, for ordinary income, pay 10%, you're going to get zero. That's a pretty big difference. And 28 goes all the way down to 15, 39 goes all the way down to 20. So it's clearly advantageous to have something be a capital gain. So if there's both a net long-term and short-term gain, the net capital gain is net a long-term capital gain. Short-term capital gains are treated as ordinary income, so there's no benefit for these lower tax rates. All right. So previous example, this capital gain, okay, would be paid on at the lower tax rates. Right, so if you calculate their overall tax, there's also this other category called qualified dividends, which are treated together. That's most dividends from regular corporations and net capital gains are both kind of in the same category. Tax law puts them in the same bucket, you might say. And to calculate their tax, we have to basically take those out, calculate the tax without them, and then calculate the tax separate on those items. That's essentially what happens. Okay, we've already talked about these different rates. So, an example, best way to look at this, Abby has $135,000, $15,000 of net capital gain. We take out the capital gain, we get $120,000. We calculate the tax using the regular tax rate tables at the front of your textbook. We get the tax on $120,000 as if the $15,000 didn't exist. Then we calculate separately the $15,000, the tax on the $15,000. Down here is as if we did it with her much higher tax bracket, which means she's going to pay 20% on her capital gain, not 15%. It's the only difference. All right, so there's how you separate out and then calculate tax in two steps. What if you're kind of on the borderline between two tax brackets? Well, then part of it may be taxed at a lower rate and part at a higher rate. So example here, $50,000, which is in the 25 tax bracket, but once you take out the qualified capital gain, she's only at 35, which is in the 15%. So to the amount up to get her into the next tax bracket, she pays on the capital gain at 0%. So $29.50 at 0%, and then the rest of the $15,000 at 15%, which is her the next step up in terms of capital gains rates. So you don't just get a blanket to do it on all of it if you're on the in between or on the borderline between tax brackets. Capital losses, if everything gets netted together and you have a capital loss, you could only use $3,000. So there's the downside of capital assets is if you have a capital loss, you can only deduct $3,000 or maybe $1,500 if you're married probably separately against ordinary income. You always use your short-term capital losses first, okay? And anything capital losses maintain their nature, either short-term or long-term, to carry forward to next year. So it's not like they go away completely. They carry over for as long as you're alive. So if you have a large capital loss, you may have to use it up $3,000 at a time over many years. So we'll see some exceptions to that a little later, but the general rule is capital losses can only be used up to $3,000. So on the plus side, capital gains are taxed at a lower tax bracket. On the negative side, capital losses are limited. Where if it had been an ordinary loss, it would not be limited. So here's an example of short-term, long-term. We've always used short-term first. We utilize 2,500 of the short-term. Remember, the total we can use is 3,000, so that leaves us only $500 left for long-term. And we get to use 500 now, and 6,800 will carry over to next year and continue to be utilized to offset capital gains or ordinary income in future years. All right, let's go through the Form 8949 on our next podcast, part two, having to do with these capital gains and losses. So we'll stop there and pick up again on the Schedule D.